Praise God. Good evening. In Psalms 84:10, it says, "Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked." Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. It's always good to be in the presence of God. Amen. Whether it be in your in the house or in the bathroom or whatever, presence of God. It's always good to be in His presence. Great things happen in the presence of God. That's why we're always emphasizing prayer. It is so important to pray. Amen. So important to pray. I just want to remind everyone that this is not a social club, but it's a place where we come into the presence of God. Amen. So let's bow our heads. Let's pray. Father God, I know it's not in the flattery of words, Father God, in the way we pray that pleases you. But I know it's what you see in our hearts, the purity of our hearts, Father God. I pray that our hearts are pure when we pray. I know, Father God, that you are pleased when we have faith as we pray. I pray that you would give us faith tonight, Father God, when we pray. I pray that everything we do tonight would please you. Help us never to take your glory, Father God. I pray that no man, no woman would take your glory, Father God. I pray that we would not take your crown, Father God. But Father God, I pray, Father God, that you would always be on this, on the pedestal in this church. Only the name of Jesus, Father God, would be glorified in this church. I come against any form of pride in the leadership of this church. But I pray that we would always be humble, Father God. Keep us humble. Anytime that pride starts creeping in our hearts, I pray, Father God, that you would just discipline us right away. Cut it from the root, oh God, that we would always be humble, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Yes, Father God. I pray that you would use our pastors to minister tonight, including the leadership of this church. I pray, Father God, your anointing upon the word tonight, that it would come go forth in power. Yes, Father God. I pray, Father God, in the name of Jesus, that you would set people free, Father God, from bondages, addictions, Father God, in the name of Jesus. I pray, Father God, those who are going through deep trials, I pray, Father God, that you would just comfort them, Father God. Those who need answers, Father God, I pray that you would give those solutions tonight, Father, in the name of Jesus. I just pray that your holy presence would be felt tonight by young and old tonight, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Have your way tonight. Have your way tonight, Father God. We just want to say, we love you, Father. We love you, Jesus, and we love you, Holy Spirit. Let us all stand. Thank you, Father God. Yes, Father God. We worship you. We glorify you because you are worthy to be praised.
Yes, you are.
Thank you, Father God. You are worthy to be praised.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
You are worthy to be praised.
Give him a clap offering. Hallelujah. The Lord is worthy. Hallelujah. He is holy and he's worthy tonight. Hallelujah. Are you ready to sing to the Lord? Amen. Amen. Let's go. Church, let's worship the Lord tonight.
Thank you.
Yes, you are.
Just bow our heads for a moment. Close your eyes with me, please. Just take a few more minutes just to thank God for His goodness. We're all here today because of God. We've come this far in life only because of God. So just give thanks to God tonight for all that He's done in your life. Try to look at the things that you went through, the trials, the difficulties in life. But you're here today. It's because of God. It's because of His goodness. So just take this time just to give thanks to Him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you so much, Lord. Yes, Lord, once again, we acknowledge Your presence and we thank You for Your goodness in our lives. Help us, Lord God, to always be aware of Your presence. Help us always, Lord God, to give thanks for Your goodness, Lord. Help us, Lord God, to not lose sight of You, to always have our heart and minds focus on You, Lord God. Lord, we love You and we thank You, Lord God, so much. Give You all thanks and praise. Amen. Amen. Thank You, Lord. So we have some visitors here with us tonight that we want to welcome. So when I call your name, kung pwede po kayo lumapit sa harapan, if you can come forward, and then we have something to give you, and we'd like to pray for you. So if it's your first time here, we'd like to welcome you. Let's first welcome some friends of Sue Dracy. Let's welcome Mark, Mac, Johnny, and May. Nasaan sila? Mark, Mac, Johnny, and May. Over here, okay. Dito kayo, lapit kayo sa harap. Dito kayo. And also, we have a friend of Sandra De Paz, si Patricia Navarro. Nasaan si Patricia? Patricia, nasaan ka? Yun. Lapit ka dito sa harapan. We'd like to just take time to pray for you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Is there anyone else na hindi namin nakuha yung pangalan nyo? Anyone else? First time here tonight? We also have a Bible to give you in case you don't have a Bible. So if it's your first time here tonight, you can please come forward. Anyone else? First time? Anong pangalan mo? Ella May? Ella May, okay. Thank you, Lord. So church, as we pray for them, let us welcome them. Extend your hands towards our visitors and friends. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we want to take this time, Lord God, to pray for our visitors, Lord God. We know, Lord God, that as we pray for them, Lord God, that you are touching them in a very special way. Only you know, Lord God, exactly what's in their hearts, what they are going through. You know, Lord God, the deepest desires and prayers, Lord God, that they pray, Lord God, when they're alone, Lord God. And so, Father, we lift them up to you. And we pray, Lord God, that during this time of service and worship, as they listen to your word, your message, we pray, Lord God, that you would just speak to them in a special way, that you would make yourself personal to them here tonight. We know, Lord God, that tonight, them being here is not a coincidence. We do believe, Lord God, that you brought them here, and they are here, Lord God, because you made a divine appointment with them. And we just want to thank you, Lord God, that they answered to that call, and they came, Lord God. And so we know, Lord God, that tonight you're going to touch their lives, you're going to speak to their hearts, Lord God. We lift them up to you, and we welcome them here in this place, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So wag muna kayo upo. We have a card that we would like to give you. So yung card is our way of just saying thank you. Also, bago kayo umupo, si Brother Marlon over there, merong room to the right side, and he has something that he would like to give you. Also, meron siyang isi-share na konti, mga 5 minutes. So kung pwede kayo bumunta kay Brother Marlon, he'd be more than happy to share something with you. Sige po, dun po ka muna kayo for about 5 minutes. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. So again, welcome to tonight's service. May Pastor Jim come for the announcements. So before Pastor Jim comes, let's go ahead and pray for the birthday celebrant. So if it's your birthday in the month of July, please stand up and come forward. Lahat ng birthday celebrants. Who are you? July. Who else? July. Si Aaron, July. Meron pa. Itoy, nasan si Itoy? June. July na pala ngayon. Pwede ulit, ulitin mo. Okay, so lahat ng birthday celebrants, happy birthday sa inyong lahat. Saan kayo magsa-celebrate? Sabi mo lang sa akin. We'd gladly eat the food that you prepare for us. So happy birthday sa inyo. Church, once again, let's extend our hands towards our birthday celebrants. Again, Lord God, we know, Lord God, that when we pray, Lord, this is not just part of our program. But Lord God, this is our way, Lord God, of making the birthday celebrants feel special, Lord God. And so we pray, Lord God, as we do pray for them, that you would touch them, Lord God, that they would experience your love, And especially, Lord God, on that special day that they were born, that their birthday, Lord God, we pray that on that special day that they will know, Lord God, that you are love. We pray, Lord God, that more than the material gifts, Lord God, that could be given to them, we pray, Lord God, that they will understand and experience the greatest gift of all, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, in their hearts and lives. And so, Father, we speak a blessing over them, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Church, just speak a blessing over their lives in the name of Jesus. Just pray blessings over their lives. Father, we pray, Lord God, that your will be done, Lord God, in their lives. Lord God, as they face life, Lord God, as they make decisions in life, Lord God, we just pray, Lord God, that you will lead and guide them in your ways, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Again, thank you, Father, for blessing them, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Don't leave, dear. Okay. So there's a small token gift that we have for you. Again, I always announce it's a keychain. Sorry, there's no key to the car or key to the house. Key holder pala.
Let's talk to the Lord this evening. Father, we thank you for this evening. We thank you, Father, for your presence in our lives. We thank you for your presence in this place. Your word says, O God, that wherever two or three are gathered in your name, that you are in their midst. So, Father, we acknowledge Jesus is here. Narito ang ating Panginoon, mga kapatid. And where his presence is, there is freedom. Where his presence is, there is healing. Where his presence is, there is peace. There is joy. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father. Salamat. Lord, we lift up our nation and we pray that you would protect our nation from the evil one. Father, we pray that you would pour out your spirit upon this land. Your word says, ask of me and I will give you the nations. Tonight, Father, we ask for this nation, ang aming bansang Pilipinas, Panginoon. We truly love this nation, Father. And Father, we know that you love this nation as well. So Lord, we stand in the gap on behalf of this nation, that in this nation, Jesus would be exalted. That in this nation, Christ only would be lifted up. Oh, Father, we pray that in this nation, that we would always have the freedom to worship you. That we would always have the freedom to pray wherever and whenever. Father, that in the schools, our students can pray. Our teachers can pray. Father, in government offices, that we could pray. And we could share the word. Father, we pray that in the business sector, Christ would be exalted. Father, we pray that in the streets, in the barangays, that Jesus Christ would be exalted. Father, we lift up our president down to the lowest government position, Panginoon. And we just pray your anointing to flow through our government, Father. Because we understand that our government is appointed by you. So Lord, we lift them up unto you and we ask for your spirit to move sa aming gobyerno, Panginoon. Father, we lift them up and we pray for their salvation in the name of Jesus. We lift up Olongapo City and we lift up the nearby towns, Panginoon. And we pray, Father, for your spirit to flow. We pray, Father God, that the leadership of this city, leadership of Subic, of Bataan, of Pampanga, these areas, even SBMA, that the leadership would be touched by you, Father. Father, we give you praise. Salamat po. Father, we lift up the church in this city, in the nearby towns, and we ask that you would unite us, O God. We lift up the different church organizations, different Christian organizations, the different mission organizations, Panginoon. Lord, we ask that you would bind us together and use us to exalt the one God. Kami po ay magkaisa. Father, we pray for this local body, the Church of the Risen Christ, and we ask that you would unite us. And as was prayed a while ago, Lord, that you would keep us humble, that we would remain humble before you at all times. Panginoon, keep us humble, Father. Because when your people are humble, that's where your grace is. So, Father, we ask that your grace would flow in our lives, Panginoon. Brothers and sisters, please join hands. And as you do so, just start praying for one another. I know this has become somewhat of a tradition, but it is a good tradition to pray for one another and to bless one another. Father, let your unity flow in this place today, at this moment. If there is anyone here that needs healing, let your healing flow. If there is anyone here tonight that needs to be encouraged, let your encouragement flow. If there is anyone here that just needs peace, let your peace flow. Father, let your will be done in this place among all of us tonight. Salamat po, Panginoon. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let us give God a clap of praise tonight. Well, good evening, Paul. Welcome to tonight's service. God is good. Amen. 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 For our announcements tonight, as always, please place your mobile devices on silent mode during the service. Our services are broadcasted live on YouTube, and they are also available for download. So kung nais niyo po, just go to YouTube and search Church of the Risen Christ, and you'll find all of our services ready for download or live. Our website is churchoftherisenchrist.net, on which you may find our personal email addresses as well as information about the church. Also, there is a particular email address particularly for a prayer request. So if you have a prayer request and a text message is not enough, you could send us an email via our website. If you find us on Facebook, please like the page, and you will get notifications when things, you know, when we upload different news or the announcements, as well as when we go on live, you will get a notification that our services are live. We do broadcast our services live via our Facebook page as well. CRC On Air, Rajanat in Subic 91.1 Hot FM. Our morning service is broadcasted now from 6 p.m. to 8 in the evening. And po ay sa Subic 91.1 Hot FM. As well as we have a what we call a Subic Connect sa lugar po ng Subic. It is in the LPMI building, Barangay Wawandue, Subic Zambales. I Googled this place. I researched. Better don't ask for directions. Talk to Pastor Jesse. Ito po ay every first Thursday and third Thursday of the month. This coming Thursday, we will be having a Bible study. If you are in town in the Subic area at that time, Thursday, first Thursday from 5 o'clock to 7 in the evening, join us at the LPMI building, Barangay Wawandue, Subic Zambales. Our Sunday services are in the morning at 8 to 9:30, and po ang Tagalog service natin. And this is our English service, 6 p.m. to 8 in the evening. Our Wednesday night service is coming Wednesday. It being the first Wednesday of the month, we'll be having a prayer meeting. So join us for prayer on Wednesday, 7 p.m. to 8:30 in the evening. Yan po ay, also that day is a fasting day. So if you want to fast with us during the whole day, you can fast one meal. two meals, three meals, or if he cannot fast meals due to physical, like me, I can't handle not eating. Fast something else, maybe Facebook or TV or something, so that we could concentrate on God. So yun po, first Wednesday of the month, we do fast. Also, our Family Connect is this Saturday, July 9. Family Connect means that we have men's service, we have women's service, and youth service. But before we have these services, nagkakaroon po tayo ng joint time for worship. And then we break into groups, the men, the youth, and the women. And we do our own thing. So it is a nice time to bond with each other. So remember, that is July 9, every second Saturday of the month, July 9, 6 p.m. to 8 in the evening. Now, my last announcement for tonight is our 30th anniversary is next month. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. So if you notice, si Mr. Alexis ay paikot-ikot, may dalang camera. He's taking a few video clips and pictures. We are compiling stuff. So we will be showing a video during the anniversary from the old days, 1980s till now. So that will be about 30 hours of footage. But that we'll be showing a video during the time so that you'll get to know what happened in the past. If you don't know, kami ni Pastor Jesse, ako, and Pastor Arnel, we've been with the church for 30 years. Hallelujah. Grabe, no? It's hard to believe. But, you know, it's easy because I was only 3 years old when the church started. So, so I'm 33 now. 30 years. Hallelujah. So our 30th year is next month. We have four services, four Sundays in the month of August. On the fourth Sunday, it is August 28th. This will be held at the SBEC, or Subic Bay Exhibition and Convention Center, on SBMA. So it will be at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, anywhere 4 to 7 or so. The reason why we made it 4 o'clock, isang service na lamang po. No more morning service, no evening service. It will be at 4 o'clock. Because we want to compensate for the curfew. Curfew is at 9:30. If we start at 6, like now, then we'll go overtime. I'm going to heat up now, you know, for the young people like myself that has to go home at night. So we made it 4 o'clock in the afternoon to make it easier for travel. We will be arranging travel from Harbor Point, public transportation, and you only have to pay 7 or 8 pesos to get there. And then from the SBEC, they will take you back to Harbor Point as well after the service. So for those that don't have personal vehicles, you don't have to worry. As long as you can make it to the Harbor Point parking area, you'll be able to get there. And of course, if you have 16 pesos on you during that day. So please, mag-ipon-ipon na po tayo. 16 pesos. Also, as we always do every year, we have a souvenir t-shirt. We don't say that you need to get one, but if you do want to get one, they are available. For now, the price is 250 pesos, but it may go lower because see, we're working with some other printers. But there's here, it's purple because our original color was purple. I see when the church started, the Lakers were sikat yung Lakers. So we adopted their color, and it's purple. And then here's the design. Our theme is God Undeniable. Now, this is a cassette tape, if you don't know what this is. This is not a floppy disk. It is a cassette tape. I see the church started in the 80s. That's when we had to use cassette players and so forth. So this is it. If you want one, please just order from Brother Marlon. You have to pay right away kasi, you know, we can't abono 200, 300 shirts. So please do pay and we'll give you a receipt and everything. But if you're interested, just see Mr. Marlon for that. Yun lamang mga announcements. Pastor Jesse.
So about the anniversary again. From the first, second, and third Sunday, we will have members of our church, youth, ladies, children and the different groups that want to perform, present during the first, second, and third Sunday. So the morning service and the evening service will be exactly the same. So the first Sunday, it's either I will share or Pastor Arnell will share. He will share in the morning and the evening. Second Sunday, Pastor Jimmy, morning and evening. Presentations will all be the same, morning and evening. When we go to the SBEC on the fourth Sunday of the month, we have some guests. We will have back Sharon and her brother, Sharon, what's her last name? Hernandez. And we also have Gabriel Ramos, and then we have Casper, and then Tata, the saxophonist. And then, so they will be doing all the performances that day. And with the choir will also perform. And then lastly, we have a guest speaker that will be coming, actually will be coming from the U.S., and he's a good friend of ours. For those that know him, he's brother or Pastor Keith Lindsay. And so he'll be coming from the U.S., and he'll be he arranged his schedule where he can come and be here during our anniversary so that he can share. And yung totoo lang, we invited him before, when he was still living in the Philippines, we invited him twice to minister at one of our anniversaries. And every time we asked him to come, for some reason, he wasn't able to make it because of some appointments or something happened. Now he's going to be coming from the U.S. Let's pray that everything goes smoothly. He is a man of God, and we really enjoy him because we love his heart as a minister of God. Yeah, he's very godly, and that's something that we like about him. So please do pray for our anniversary this coming next month. It's a children's service today, so I'm going to ask all the children to stand, and we will pray for them before they go up. So children, please don't go up yet. Just stand up muna. Grace, tatayo ka? Umaganon eh. Let's pray for the children. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for our children. We just thank you, Lord God, for them. They are very special, Lord God, in your eyes. Help us all, always, Lord God, to see them as special, to make them feel special in this place, Lord God. Lord, as the children's teachers teach them, we pray for your anointing upon them, not only to entertain, Lord God, but to teach them your word, the word of life, Lord God. So, Lord, we lift them up to you. We thank you for them again. In Jesus' name, amen. So, lahat ng children, you may please go up. Teacher Heidi and others are waiting there for you. Okay, also before we get into the Word of God this evening, for those that don't know, every month of March to June, so 3 months, every year we have a class that's called Design for Discipleship, or in short, DFD. It's a 3-month course, and what we do every Sunday during that span of 3 months, we teach basic Bible foundational doctrines, and it happens every Sunday from 3 to 5 p.m. And so we had, we just finished last Sunday, and so we have 15 that graduated from that class. Some of them received their certificate this morning. Some of them will receive it tonight. So as I call your name, please do come, and we will award this certificate to you. And it says here, certificate of completion. This certificate is presented to blank for completing the Design for Discipleship course presented on July 3, 2016 at Church of the Risen Christ, signed by yours truly and Marlon Asano, DFD coordinator. So let's welcome and give a round of applause to those that finished the course. Let's first say call on Nita or Nitz Lim. Nitz. And then followed by her daughter, Yashar Salvatos. Congrats, Anita. also Iris Ong and her son, Sian Ong. Then we have Heidi Camales. Heidi. And Irene Mercado. Is Irene here? Is she here? Is she up? Heidi. Irene. And then Justin Leonard and Mom Justin Mendoza. Justin and Justin. And then we also have Grace Bernal. Grace. Geraldine Grace. Geraldine Grace. Sorry. Patawat po. And then Leandro Mendigorin. Leandro, is he here tonight? Leandro. Congratulations. And also lastly, is she here? Danica Arandilia. Danica, is Danica here? Danica. Oh, praise the Lord. Thank you. So God bless. And so again, we do this on a one-to-one basis, or sometimes we do it in small groups that are willing to go through the course. But regularly, we do it every year. Starts around March and ends sometime June, July, depending on how the months fall. And so if you're interested, and we do want you to be interested, if you've never been through a course like that, it's very important. Plus, those that want to get involved in any kind of ministry here at CRC, that is just one requirement. Aside from, you know, you have to have a heart from God. But then as far as the course is concerned, you must go through that course if you want to get involved in any ministry, from ushering to be a part of the prayer team, et cetera, et cetera. So please do get involved. This is for you. Amen. So are you ready for God's word tonight? Let us pray. Father, we come before you this evening once again. Lord, we give you our hearts. We give you our minds, Lord God. Lord, we know, Lord God, that if we don't give you our hearts and minds, that we won't be able to understand or comprehend your word. And we may miss out on what you are saying. And so, Father God, we offer to you our hearts and minds that you will teach us, Lord God, your ways, that we would understand your ways, Lord God. Lord, we know that we're so full of the ideas of this world and how things are done. We know that your ways are different, Lord God. So we want to learn your ways, Lord God. So tonight, Father, teach us your ways, Lord God, we pray. And we thank you for this, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So the title of my message tonight is The Praying Church. Now, you notice when I was, every time we've been talking about prayer, most of my scriptures really had nothing to do with specifically or in particular talagang prayer. So what I was teaching, things relating to prayer. Because if you don't know, understand the things that relate to prayer, then you really can't pray effectively. So although it's about prayer, but it's things relating to prayer. And so I'm going to do the same thing today. Although I will have more scriptures that will mention the word prayer, but you will notice that what I'm going to talk or share about today is not really prayer. It's related to prayer, but it's very, very important. Because as I was studying this is something I knew, but something the Lord started showing me more about. And this thing that I'm going to share, you can relate it to different parts of our Christian life, different parts of our Christian walk. It can be related to serving God, related to overcoming maybe sin in our life, et cetera, et cetera. This is so important. So I'm going to have you listen, please. Let's start by reading Acts chapter 4. We'll be reading 20 verses from verse 1 to verse 20. It says, while Peter and John were speaking to the people, they were confronted by the priest, the captain of the temple guard, and some of the Sadducees. These leaders were very disturbed that Peter and John were teaching the people through Jesus there is a resurrection of the dead. They arrested them, and since it was already evening, put them in jail until morning. But many of the people who heard their message believed it. So the number of men who believed now totaled about 5,000. The next day, the council of all the rulers and elders and teachers of religious laws met in Jerusalem. Annas the high priest was there along with Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other relatives of the high priest. They brought in the two disciples and demanded, "By what power or in whose name have you done this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of our people, are we being questioned today because we've done a good deed for a crippled man? Do you want to know how he was healed? Let me clearly state to all of you and to all the people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, the man you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead. For Jesus is the one referred to in the scriptures where it says, 'The stone that you builders rejected has now become the cornerstone.' There is salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved." The members of the council were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, for they could see that they were ordinary men with no special training in the scriptures. They also recognized them as men who had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing right there among them, there was nothing the council could say. So they ordered Peter and John out of the council chamber and confirmed among themselves. "What should we do with these men?" they asked each other. "We can't deny that they have performed the miraculous sign, and everybody in Jerusalem knows about it. But to keep them from spreading their propaganda any further, we must warn them not to speak to anyone in Jesus' name again." So they called the apostles back in and commanded them never again to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him?" Verse 20, "We cannot stop telling about everything we have seen and heard." So here's a story about Peter and John performing a miracle. 5,000 people coming to the Lord. And here the religious leaders wanted to stop them from preaching the gospel. But Peter and John replied, "Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him?" Verse 20, "We cannot stop telling about everything we have seen and heard." Now in Acts chapter 4 verse 20, from the modern English version, it says, "For we cannot help but declare what we have seen and heard." Peter and John says, "We cannot help but declare what we have seen and heard." So basically, Peter and John was saying that there was nothing that can be done to keep them quiet. That's what they were basically saying. And no matter how hard they try to keep them quiet, they just won't, they just can't. It's impossible to keep them quiet about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's going to come out of their mouths. It's like when a mother is 9 months pregnant and is ready to give birth. There's nothing you can do about it. The baby is coming out. Amen? It's coming out no matter what. I remember when Margie was pregnant with Jensen. You know, I tried to always be the cool dad. You know, Margie was already 9 months on the way. And it was evening or early morning. It was evening. And she started feeling that it was time. And so, you know, the cool me, okay, let's go, you know. We had no money, so let's pass by Jimmy. Let's see if he has money we can borrow. Knock, 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 knock. No Jimmy coming out. I guess, you know, Jesse's there. He needs money. Let's not open the gate. So we were there for quite a while. And Margie was waiting, you know, sitting in our I think it was still the Cimarron that time. And I was trying to be cool, and so Jimmy wasn't coming out. So, okay, dear, let's go. Let's try someone else. So we went to another friend's house just in case before we go to the hospital because we had zero money on us. And so that we also weren't able to contact that person, so we just went straight to the hospital. We arrived at the hospital. We contact the doctor. We arrive at the hospital, and then the hospital contacts her doctor. The doctor arrives, within 30 minutes, the baby Jensen is out. Within 30 minutes. And the doctor said, do not do that again. The next time you call me earlier. But there's nothing you can do. If I stayed home, if I said, dear, let's just stay home. Let's do it tomorrow. Or we don't have time right now. Let's try next week. If it's coming out, it's going to come out. There's nothing you can do about it. Tama? That's what Peter was saying. He said in Acts chapter 4, modern English version, we cannot help but declare what we have seen and heard. They were so full of Jesus that Jesus was going to come out of their mouth whether you like it or not. No matter what you do to try to get us to stop speaking about Jesus, there's nothing you can do. They are so full of Jesus that he's going to come out of their mouths. Amen? Luke 6:45 says, a good man of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth evil. This is a part that I want to mention or talk about. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. Out of the abundance, whatever your heart is full of, that's what's going to come out of your mouth. So Peter and John were saying, we're so full of Jesus, no matter what you do, he's going to come out of our mouth. We cannot help but speak about this Jesus because they were so full. Amplified version says, the intrinsically good man produces what is good and honorable and moral out of the good treasure stored in his heart, and the intrinsically evil man produces what is wicked and depraved out of the evil in his heart. And this part again. For his mouth speaks from the overflow of his heart. The mouth speaks from the overflow of his heart. So these scriptures tell us that whatever your heart is full of, that's what's going to come out of your mouth. Amen? Now we're talking about prayer, but we're not into the subject of prayer yet. But whatever is in your heart, that's what's going to come out. Now, I have a funny story to share. I shared this before. I'll share it again, but I talked about this in a different way. But I'm going to share this about being full. There's one time that we visited Singapore, me, Margie, and Jensen. And we had some friends in Singapore. They're Singaporeans. They invited us out to eat dinner. So they asked me, Pastor Jess, where do you want to eat? And of course, Filipino tayo, up to you, wherever you want. But they would not take up to you for an answer. So they ask, you want Chinese, you want fish, you want vegetables, you want Italian, you want meat. And when the word meat came across, I wanted meat, but my answer was, it's up to you. But they ended up asking Jensen, let's ask Jensen. So they asked Jensen, and it's meat. So it was meat all the way. So we went to this barbecue place in Singapore. It's a Brazilian barbecue and one of the best. And it's an eat-all-you-can barbecue. They had lamb. They had two kinds of beef. They had sausage. They just had everything. The difference between that eat-all-you-can is you don't go to the table. The waiters go to you. And they have the, what do you call the barbecue stick skewers? That's it. So they have that, about that long, and they go to you, and they slice off that juicy beef and lamb and what have you on your table, on your plate. And they just kept coming back and coming back and coming back and coming back, and we were full already up to here. And they came back and said, you want some? No, you must eat. And then they asked, how old are you? So they asked how old I was. Oh, you can still eat, you can still eat. They asked Jensen, how old are you? Very, very young, you eat some more. So slice. But it was really delicious. Talaga, the beef melts in your mouth. Sarap talaga. The best. And then they also had barbecue grilled, not barbecue, grilled pineapple. Ang sarap pala ng pineapple when you grill it because the it's sweet and it starts to caramelize, and when they cut it and slice it on your plate, oh, perfect. you eat the pineapple, then you can eat more beef, di ba? Ganon yun eh. So we kept eating and eating and eating. And of course, Jensen being young, he really loved it, kept eating and eating and eating. Finally, we stopped, but Jensen kept eating and eating and eating. Time to go home. He gets up, goes to the restroom first, then walks out the front door of the restaurant. This was not in a mall, so it was in the street somewhere. So he walks out a few steps and he stops. Dad, I don't feel good. So, you know, from the door to the restroom is about from here to the back of that church. That's the distance from the door to the restroom. And I was thinking, he really looked bad. And I was thinking, how am I going to get him from here to the restroom? It didn't happen. We were outside the front door of the restaurant on the sidewalk. And there's nothing you can do. It's going to come out. It came out. But I know another story. I'm not mentioning names. Another story of another person who ate at the same place. Ate at the same place. Ate so much. There's nothing you can do. It's going to come out. Thank God it didn't come out, because it wanted to come out the other end. Excuse me. Excuse me on that. But that's what happens. You know, when you're so full of something, there's only one thing that's going to happen. It's going to come out. Everything we do as Christians, relating to our walk with Christ, our life in Christ, should be a result of an overflow from our hearts. Amen. It should be an overflow from evangelizing or sharing the gospel, to praising and worshiping God, to coming to church and fellowshipping, to the giving of our tithes and offerings and prayer. All of this should not be something that we are forced to do. It should not be something that we are obligated to do, something that we have to do, but it must be a result of an overflow from our hearts. Amen? Because when you are so full of God, there's nothing that can stop you from wanting to serve God, wanting you to share others about God, wanting you to talk and to pray to God. Now, I believe that we shouldn't establish church programs to get members to participate. I don't believe that. I don't believe let's do more programs so more people will get involved, because the people are not doing nothing. We need more programs. I don't believe that. Programs should be established as a result of an overflow. Pastor, we want to pray more. Pastor, we want to evangelize. We want to do it in an organized manner. How can we do this? Then you start the programs to assist what's already in the people's hearts. Not to get them to do something, but because of an overflow, you develop these programs so they can express what is already in their hearts. So relating it to prayer, it shouldn't be let's start some new prayer programs to get people to pray. It should be because the people have such a desire to pray, let's begin some programs. Lord, we want to pray. Pastor, we want to pray for the staff on a regular basis. How can we do that? Okay, let's organize. Okay, the staff is at church at such and such a time. Maybe you can come as a group and pray for us. Out of the desire, you start those programs. You don't start programs to try to create the desire. It's the heart's desire. It must be an overflow of God in our hearts. Prayer is not something that the church should be forced to do, but something that the church wants to do. It should be something natural. Amen? It should be something that the church wants to do, something that the church desires to do. In fact, our lives in Christ is not a result of trying hard. And I want to insert this. Some people try so hard to be a Christian. Some people try so hard to do the right thing. It doesn't work that way. It does not. You can try your hardest, but if you're not full with God, it's not going to happen. It won't happen. That's just the way it is, because the Bible said it's not by power. But by the Spirit, says the Lord. And that's why we fail many times, because we're trying to do it in our own strength. We try to do it on our own. We try hard. And you know, it's a good thing that we have that desire to try hard, but it's not done that way. Christianity is an outflow of God in us. The way we live is because God is so full in us, because we're so full of God, our lives expresses God. The way we talk, the way we live, the way we relate to people, it's an expression of something that's overflowing from our hearts. Do you have to force a dog to bark? No. Yung aso namin, sometimes you do. We have a dog, we bought a dog. 2.5 years ago, we bought a dog. We thought, oh, this will be a nice watchdog. He's a boxer. Already 6-8 months old, going to a year, never heard him bark. What's wrong with my dog? He got cats passing by, he got people passing by, people knocking on the gate. He doesn't bark. So I do some research. And yung pala, boxers are not barkers. They don't bark a lot. So, wrong dog. Anyway, wrong dog for someone to alert me. Anyway, you don't force a dog to bark. You don't force a cat to meow. You don't force a frog to croak. You know, all those are natural. It's instinct. It's natural. Now, though we have to be taught how to pray the biblical way, we need to be taught the biblical principles of prayer, but talking to God, conversing with God, should be very natural to the Christian. Amen? It should be something that you want to do. But if you're so full of God, it's something that you want to do. It's something that is in your heart. It's a desire. And there's nothing that you can stop you, program or no program. I'm going to pray because I'm so full of God. I want more of Him. I want to talk to Him. I want to converse with Him. The Bible says that my house shall be called a house of prayer. Amen? My house shall be called a house of prayer. And when you go to a, you know, house of pancakes, what do you find? You sure, pancakes? Of course. You should find pancakes, and you should find the best. But then I went to a pancake house. What's that place called? Pancake House. No, not here. It's the States. And I was expecting the best pancakes. I ordered this pancake, huh? IHOP, yeah. I was expecting the best pancakes, and here I'm eating the pancakes, and Albert's pancakes were better. But you know, when you go to a pancake house, you know, you find pancakes. When you go to the church, God says, my house shall be called the house of prayer. Prayer should be natural. Prayer should be something that overflows in us. But it's a sad thing, you know, you hear it mentioned amongst, you know, Christians, that, you know, you have a prayer meeting and maybe you get a handful of people. Diba? You have a dinner meeting and you can't, there's not enough room to seat the people. Diba? You know, it's sad. Kami din, mga pastors. You know, you have a prayer meeting for pastors and you have a handful of people show up or less. You have a dinner meeting, free dinner meeting, and there's not enough room to house pastors and leaders. It's sad, but then it's not supposed to be. The reason why it happens that way, because we're not really that full. And God is not overflowing. And so what happens, we do things in our own strength, and it doesn't work. Prayer should be an outflow, an overflow of God in our lives. Acts 1, verse 14. Let's look at some scriptures that mention the word prayer. They all met together, talking about the early church here. We're going to be reading scriptures from Acts, and talks about the early church. They all met together and were constantly united in prayer, along with Mary and the mother of Jesus, several other women, and the brothers of Jesus. The Bible says that the early church were constantly united in prayer. Constant. You know, when you read Acts, the early church, you don't hear about them organizing prayer meetings. You don't hear them. You don't hear about them organizing evangelistic meetings. It just happens. It's so natural. It happens. They were constantly united in prayer. It was a natural thing. It was constant. Acts 12:5. But while Peter was in prison, the church prayed for very earnestly for him. So when Peter was in prison, the church knew, let's pray. It was automatic. And it was not a religious thing. It was real. Acts 21 verse 12. When we returned to the ship at the end of the week, the entire congregation, the whole church, including women and children, left the city and came down to the shore with us. They knelt and prayed. The entire church, the congregation, prayed to send off the Apostle Paul on his next missionary journey. The whole congregation came. Children and women came with the men, and they prayed. Acts 13, 1-3. Among the prophets and teachers of the church at Antioch of Syria were Barnabas, Simeon, called the Black Man, Lucius from Cyrene, Manaen, and the childhood companion of King Herod, Antipas. One day as these men were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, appoint Barnabas and Saul for a special work to which I have called them. So after more fasting and prayer, the men laid hands on them and sent them on their way. When they were praying. See, this is when leaders are raised up. While they were praying, God appointed leaders. God appointed leaders. Leaders are not man appointed. They are God appointed. But it only happens in the atmosphere of prayer. Acts 20 verse 36. And when he had finished speaking, he knelt and prayed with them. Prayer was a practice after sharing a message. After he finished speaking, he knelt and prayed with them. Acts 1 verse 24 to verse 25. Then they all prayed, O Lord, you know every heart. Show us which of these men you have chosen as an apostle to replace Judas in his ministry. For he has deserted us and has gone where he belongs. So again, in prayer, God starts to choose leaders. It's not by votation. It's not by election. It's appointed by God. Acts 6:6. These seven men were presented to the apostles who prayed for them as they laid their hands on them. And not only leaders, but considered helpers in the church are prayed about. Lord, do you choose these men to help out in the serving ministry? It's just like when we took on Oliver, our caretaker. We prayed. And by the way, Brother Roy also now is helping with the cleaning ministry and helping us maintain the church. But we prayed, we asked the Lord to lead us and to guide us. You know, we several months that we were thinking of who we can use to help us out here. And so we believe that the Lord appointed Roy to be part of the cleaning ministry here at church. So even simple things like that need to be prayed about. Acts 16, verse 25, 22 to 25. A mob quickly formed against Paul and Silas, and the city officials ordered them stripped and beaten with wooden rods. They were severely beaten, and then they were thrown into prison. The jailer was ordered to make sure they didn't escape. So the jailer put them into the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in the stocks. Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening. Now, if you read the whole story of that, of Paul being in prison, you find out that he was released from prison miraculously. But see, that's when he was singing at this point, was not a result of him being set free. He was still in chains at this time. He was still in prison at this time. And even in prison, even in chains, he was singing hymns to God as a prisoner. Amen. So we don't thank God. We don't praise God. We don't pray only after we're delivered. It needs to happen all the time. During and in the middle of trials, the church prayed. Prayer was a natural response for every circumstance. When faced with decisions, when faced with trials, when choosing, when traveling, the church prayed. It was natural for them. It was something that they did. The early church was so full of God that they went to God in prayer for every decision, every trial, for everything. They were so full of God that that was the expression of their lives, prayer. They prayed. And that's why they experienced so many miracles. If you read the book of Acts, you will find out that, you know, miracles after miracles were done by the apostles during that time. But church, listen. The miracles did not happen because they prayed. It didn't happen because they prayed. It happened because they were so full of God. And their prayer was a result of being full of God. You could pray your breath out. You could pray until... if you're not full of God, nothing is going to happen. Amen? You can pray for the sick. You can pray for those that are depressed. You can pray so hard, but if you're not full of God, nothing is going to happen. Miracles happen not because they prayed, but because they were so full of God. Prayers was a result of being full of God. And that's why miracles happen. And it was this God-filled prayer that brought in the many miracles, signs, and wonders that they saw and experienced. Not religious formulated prayers, but God-filled prayers. Like Pastor Jimmy shared, we've been here at the Church of the Risen Christ for 30 years from the beginning. We were the pioneers of this church. We've been a Christian for over something like 35 years already. And throughout those years, you know, you see a lot of things. You hear a lot of things. And it's sad, but there has been so many formulas that has been taught Christianity and how to pray. How to pray for the sick. If you know what I'm talking about, there were books being sold during those days. They had a red book, and I think there was a blue book. And how to pray for the sick. Step by step, hands out, and so forth and so on. Check the height of one shoulder, the hip, are they equal? And then it's formulated how to pray. I don't care what formulas you have. If you're not full of God, nothing is going to happen. Miracles, answered prayers is not praying. It's a result of us being full of God. Because when we're so full of God, then we respond to God always in prayer. Prayer should be a natural outflow, a result of an abundance of God and His Spirit in us that produces in us a more prayerful life. When you have God in your life, and when God is overflowing in your life, it expresses itself in prayer. So my encouragement to you is not so much to pray or to pray. My encouragement to you is to be filled with God and His Spirit so that prayer becomes natural to you. So we can say pray, that's a good thing. But if you're not full of God, your prayers is not a good thing. It's just religious. It's dead prayer. So my encouragement to you is not to pray. It's not to pray more. My encouragement to you is to be filled with God and His Spirit so that prayer becomes natural. Every good and godly thing that happens in our life is a result of God. Amen. There's nothing we can do. So everything that good that happens to us is a result of God. We love Him because He first loved us. We can never boast that I love God because it's a result of His love that we love Him. We have faith because of what He did. Where would our faith be if He did not do what He did? So we have faith in as a result of what He did. To be filled with God is a result of God pouring out Himself on us. So in order for us to be filled with God, we understand that He's the one who's going to pour out Himself on us. But how does that happen? See, even though every good and godly work is a result of what He's doing, the one thing that we must do that God cannot do, the one thing that you and I must do that God cannot do, is to choose, to decide. God cannot decide for you what you want. God cannot choose for you what you want. He can influence our decisions by sending people to us to speak into our lives. He can influence our decisions through the preaching of God's word. He can influence our decisions as people pray for you and the Spirit of God moves upon you. But he cannot decide for you. He cannot manipulate our decisions. He gave that to us. He gave us the free will to decide and to choose. And so for God to pour out his life upon us, we need to want it. We need to decide. And the decision that we make is not only a verbal decision, but it's a decision that we make every day. Lord, fill me. I want more of you. You find yourself in life, you know, getting involved in so many things that you're forgetting God. God reminds you, hey, you're empty. You're growing empty. You need me. You stop and you decide, Lord, I'm sorry. I forgot about you. I put you aside. Lord, I decide today, fill me. We need to make a decision to want to be full of God. Although he is the one that pours his life to us, he cannot and will not force himself in us or onto us. We need to decide. Joshua 24, verse 14 to verse 15 says, so fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshipped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt. Serve the Lord alone. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates? Or will it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live? But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. So it says here, you choose. But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. So you see, God gives us the right to decide. And once we decide, then God steps in. Then he steps in and he pours himself into us. And that's when we see our lives transform. That's when our minds change. That's when the way we talk changed. Because we're now so full of God, what's coming out of our mouths now is not what used to come out. It's changed. The way you think is no longer the way you used to think, because that's being, flushed out by the presence of God. You're being full. You're being filled. Now, as you know, when you take a bottle of Coke and you put it under the faucet and you turn the faucet on, eventually all the Coke will be flushed out and it will be just water. In the same way, when we constantly go to God, his presence, his word in us begins to flush out those things that don't belong in us anymore. We start to think different. We start to talk different. We're no longer as judgmental as we used to be. God is changing us from glory to glory. But we need to decide to want him. We need to decide, and it's not just a one-time decision, it's a daily decision, because our walk is daily. Like I said, sometimes we get off in life, sometimes we forget God, and then God reminds us, you're off, you're growing empty, your life is going back to your old ways, you're thinking the same way, your words are the same way it used to be, you need more of me. You're reminded, you get back and you say, Lord, I'm sorry, forgive me. Cleanse me and fill me. So it's not just a decision the day that you receive Christ, but it's a daily decision of wanting to be filled with Christ. And then the Lord says in 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9, the eyes of the Lord search the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to the Lord. God is on the lookout. God is on the lookout. He's looking for those whose hearts are committed to him. He's looking for those that choose him. And he says that he will strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. God will fill you. if you choose Him. Amen. God will fill you. So church, remember this. As a whole, Christianity is not about what you do. It's about what He does in us. Amen. You can never walk the Christian walk by trying hard. Remember that. You can never walk the Christian walk by trying hard. You can never pray the way God wants us to pray by trying hard. What we need to do is choose today and every day. Lord, fill me. Fill me. And when He fills you, then He begins to flush out those things, the old ways, and then your ways change. Not by might, nor by power, but by the Spirit, says the Lord. Amen. So if you look at your life, and you're seeing here, you're struggling there, you just can't understand why. And your heart seems to be right. Lord, I want this. I want to change. I want to do what is right. But you're frustrated because you can't seem to make the right moves. It seems like your life is still right direction. It's because you're trying. Remember, Christianity is not about what you do. It's about what He does in us. You can never walk or live the Christian life unless He walks in us, unless He lives in us, unless He lives in us. That's why Peter and John says, we cannot help. Nothing can stop us, because they were so full of God, so full of Jesus. When you're so full of God, when you're so full of Jesus, you will walk the walk. You don't have to try. It becomes natural. Just as natural as it is for a sinner to sin, it will become as natural to you as a Christian to walk with God, to live for God, to love God, to serve God. Amen. Amen. Bow your heads with me, church. Thank you, Jesus. Just think about what was said. Let me reemphasize on prayer. We've been talking about miracles. We're talking about now miracles related to prayer. Miracles don't come as a result of prayer. Miracles come as a result of us being full of God. Then when we pray, it's God. So what we need is not more programs. What we need is not force rules and regulations on what we should do. What we need is more of God. What we need is to make a decision. Lord, I want You. Fill me, Lord. Fill me to overflowing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Let's all stand to our feet. Just lift up your hands to God. With your hands lifted up, let this be a sign of surrender and a sign of, Lord, I want You. If that's what You want, if you're surrendering more of your life today, and if you want more of God today in your life, lift up your hands to God as a sign of surrender and as a sign of, Lord, I want more of You. I want more of You, Lord. Me, Lord God, and flush out the old ways, flush out the old life, flush out the old way of thinking, Lord God, the old way of living, Lord God. Fill me, Lord. Lord, I can't, but You can. You can through me, Lord God. Call out to Him. Call out to Him. Thank You, Father. Thank You, Jesus.
Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that as we decide today to choose you, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord God, that you would fill us. Church, call on him. Ask him to fill you. Call on him. Ask him to fill you right now in the name of Jesus. Call on him. Ask him to fill you. Lord, fill me. Fill me, Lord. Commitment to God. Some of you here tonight, you've been a Christian, let's say, for some time. However long that is not the point. But you are a Christian already. But today, I believe that there's some of you here today that you need to just make a recommitment to God. Maybe you have walked away. Maybe you have lived life your own way. Whatever the reason be, if you feel that the Lord wants you tonight to make a recommitment to him, decide today. Decide today. Come forward right now in the name of Jesus. Come forward right now. If you need to recommit your life to God, let this be the day of your recommitment to him. Let this be the day that he begins to fill you once again in the name of Jesus. Come now to the front wherever you are. Come now in Jesus' name. Come now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Just come in the name of Jesus. Just come in the name of Jesus. Let him do it. Let him do it. Let him do it. Let him do it in your life. Remember, Christianity is not about what you do. It's about what he does and what he did in you. Come in the name of Jesus. As you come, give your hearts to God and make that recommitment. This is between you and God. Talk to him. Talk to him about your life. Talk to him about the recommitment that you want to make to God tonight. You talk to him. Give him your heart. Give him your heart. Hallelujah. If there's anyone else that needs to come, just keep coming. Just keep coming. I'm going to be quiet for a while and give you an opportunity to talk to God so that you don't hear my voice. But if there's anyone that needs to come, come right now in the name of Jesus and just offer your life to God. Recommit to God. Drawing you right now. God is speaking to your heart. Come back. come back to me. Draw back to me. Make that recommitment. If God is speaking to your heart, just keep coming to the front right now. You're all I want. What we need. So Lord God, as they surrender, as we surrender, as we recommit, Lord God, to be filled with you more and more. Lord, we ask, Lord God, fill us to overflowing. Let our lives be an expression of an overflow of you. Not us, but you, Lord God. Not us, but you. Love you, Father. We thank you, Lord God, that each day you are here, Lord God, to fill us, to be with us, Lord God. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. I'm going to ask you just to remain in God's spirit, his presence, and quietly return to your seats. You may be seated, but please do remain quiet. I have one thing else that I would like to do in prayer tonight. Close your eyes, bow your heads. Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and we will share a meal together as friends. God knocks at the door of our hearts. There may be some of you here tonight, I don't know. Only God knows and you know. But there may be some of you here tonight that has never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. Your life is empty. And your life seems to be going nowhere. And so he knocks. He knocks at the door of our heart because he wants to fill us. Salvation is a work of God. New life is a work of God. Choose out of your own free will to say, Jesus, I want you. I want you more than anything else. I want you in my life. If you don't have Jesus in your life yet, and you want him to be in your life, today you can make that decision. By saying a simple prayer, you can invite Jesus into your life. And he'll begin to show you the way. And he'll begin to reign in your life. And you will have new life in Christ Jesus. Listen carefully. There are many people that don't decide
or they decide to not accept Jesus Christ as Lord because they think that they can't change. And so they say, I can never change. I can never be good enough for God. I can never be good enough for Jesus. And so I don't want to become a Christian because I'll never be good enough. The truth is true. You're not enough on your own. And you can never be a Christian on your own. That's why we need Jesus. See, like I've been saying, when we go to God, when we go to Jesus, He's the one that fills us and flushes out the old in our lives and gives us new life. You can't do that on your own. You cannot change your life on your own and then go to God. It doesn't work that way. You come to God, make a decision and say, Lord, I need you. My life is a mess. My life is going nowhere. I need you. And when you decide to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and then He steps in and He begins to help you and strengthen you and fill you, and then you'll begin to see that your life is now being changed. You think different. You talk different. The desires of your heart is different. It's not because of your doing, but because of the doing of God in your life. So don't let those things, don't let your mind hinder you from accepting Jesus, saying that I'm not good enough. Come to Him. He'll change that. He will change that. So tonight, with your eyes closed and your heads bowed, if you have never made Jesus Lord of your life, if He's not in your heart, and you want Him to be in your heart and in your life, make the decision today. Your own free will, say, yes, Lord, I want you in my life. If you want Jesus in your life, I'm going to ask you to raise up your right hand. Taas mo lang ang kanang kamay mo. If there's anyone here tonight that wants Jesus in their lives, amen. Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Meron pa ba? Thank you, Lord. If there's anyone else, I'm going to ask those na nagtaas ng kamay, kung pwede lang kayo lumapit dito sa harapan. Yung mga nagtaas ng kamay, lapit lang dito sa harapan. Brad, dito. Dito. You can come, please, forward. And if there's anyone else that wants to open your heart and accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, please do come forward. Open your heart to Jesus. Accept Him into your heart. And allow Him just to make your life in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. My wife will lead you in a prayer. Dito po kayo, just gather closer. My wife will lead you in a prayer to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. As she's leading them in prayer, let's just be quiet before the Lord. Remain in that attitude of prayer.
give the Lord a clap of praise. Thank you, Lord. Congratulations, Señor Lahat. God bless you, brother. Sarap makita yung mga young men giving their hearts to God. And you know, tears on their face, having an encounter with God. Amen. Sarap tignan, di ba? Hallelujah. God is good. Thank you, Jesus. All stand once again. Father, we want to thank you for who you are, what you've done. We want more of you, Lord. We want more of you, Lord God. Thank you, Father. Now, before we end tonight's service, after the offering, there's an overflow room. There will be a few prayer counselors that's offering their time to pray for you. If you still want prayer, if you need prayer for anything, there will be people there that will pray for you. All you got to do is go there. Now, in case wala pa sila dun, just wait on them. They will come. In case the prayer team goes ahead and there's no people praying, just give a little bit time. And then when people come, then just begin praying. So is there anyone here still that would like to be prayed for? Just raise your hand if you want to be prayed for, so we have an idea if there's still anyone that wants prayer. Anyone by? Is there anyone? Anyone? Just raise your hand. Is there anyone? Okay, so by a show of hands, voila. But just in case, on the way out, you say, oh, I need prayer. There will still be people there, okay? So it's very important if we want to pray for you. So let's offer our tithes and offerings to the Lord. Lord, again, we come before you with our tithes and offering again, Lord God. We don't do this, Lord God, because we're obligated, because we have to, because we're being forced to. This is an outflow of our love for you, Lord God. We love you. We love the church. We love your kingdom, and we want to build it. We want to be used by you. And so what we give, Lord, because of an outflow, Lord God, of our love for you. We love you, Father. Receive our tithes, our offering, Lord God, as a worship, Lord God, unto you. We pray this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's give unto the Lord.
Oh, so be.